Captain Sir is top advisor to two commandants of the Marine Corps and only one of four African American Marines to wear the rank of three-star general. In October the 17th of 2014, he, myself, and our mutual friend, United States Ambassador Theodore Benton, who could not be here with us this evening, were in attendance at the passage of command ceremony as command passed from General James F. Davis to General Joseph Conford Jr. at the Marine Corps Base 89 in Washington, D.C. However, short-lived because he was handpicked by President Barack Obama to serve as chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. So, ladies and gentlemen, the next voice that you will hear will be none other than Lieutenant General Willie Williams, United States Marine Corps retired. Let's welcome him as he approaches the podium.
Because you truly are helping our country live up to those promises and those mandates about the founding fathers and the Constitution of the United States. In fact, I would say that all of you here are helping our country with that, because we know that we have issues sometimes with that. And when I look at what all the things that have happened this past week, when I look at all the events that have taken place, and then to know that you all are here celebrating this torchbearers of democracy on this day, I mean, it's just, it makes me proud to know that we are, in fact, carrying on a legacy that has been set for us. And I think it's very fitting, especially when you think about that, and you think about the Monument of Point Reyes and what they mean to that overall democracy and what they had to do in order to serve. You know, we often say that that they had to fight for the right to fight. You know, they had to fight on multiple fronts as they went through. And so those Monument of Point Reyes of yesterday and of today, they truly are the torchbearers of democracy. And one thing I forgot to mention when I first started speaking is I didn't tell Robert, when he asked me to come up and speak, to be the keynote speaker is what they say, right? But I don't do speeches, so I just have to tell you that I don't do speeches. I have what we call one-way conversations, so I just want to talk to you. I don't give a speech, so I'll just talk. I'll just have a one-way conversation with you, because as I look back and I look at history, I can tell you, you know, there has been, especially when I think about the Montgomery's and I think about the wars and think about what all happened throughout history, you know, there was never a war that was fought either by the United States of America or within the United States of America in which African Americans did not participate. And I think about that, and I said, but from whether it be from the war for independence, where we had all black units up in Rhode Island that was fighting in Massachusetts, and to the War of 1812, where about one quarter of the Navy that was involved in the Battle of Lake Erie, I mean, you know, there was black, to the Civil War, where there was about 190,000 African Americans who was fighting for their own freedom. And in World War I, you know, there was over 350 blacks that served on the Western Front. But you know, prior to that, and prior to 1941, black men and women were denied the honor and the glory that comes with uniformed services. And their contribution went largely unnoticed. And it went so much that even when our nation stood in need of those manpower that they need to go and fight the battle, we systematically denied the people the opportunity to do so. You know, that makes absolutely no sense in the world, right? If you're in business and you think, but that makes no sense. I mean, I need manpower, but yet still I'm going to deny those of a particular color the right to provide that manpower that I need. I mean, that if you're in business, that's one of those things that you don't, you just don't see. And I, you know, when I look at that, and I thought about what George Washington, when he was President and General George Washington, what he told our nation back as far as it's 1789, and he said that the willingness with which our young people are likely to serve in any war, no matter how justified that war may be, shall be directly proportional to how they perceive the veterans of earlier wars have been treated and appreciated by their country. So it is a wonder that we were able to prepare and to raise an armed force when all the young folks had to do was to look at how our African American, our blacks, and how people of color were being treated back in that time. So it just amazed me that the Montgomery Point Marines continue to fight for that right to be up and to join this. Now, you know, in history points to it. It points to a people who had served in every war, who had served honorably, and yet still they were treated as something less than human here at home. Which is just, it was just mind-boggling to me. You know, the units were segregated, the black infantry units, they hardly saw battlefield, they were serving in other types of field. And so although they was honoring our nation with service, our nation did not honor their service. But then, you know, on the 25th of June, 1941, President Franklin Roosevelt, he changed all that. And he issued an executive order, 8802, that prohibited racial discrimination in our nation's military. And I think that was the first action, you think, when you look at history, one of the first actions of equal opportunity in the United States. So the military was paving the way even back then. It was this torchbearers to say of democracy even back then, when that was so. And what happened is that once that order was issued, you know, immediately we had people of color who was answering the call, and they were joining all branches of military service. And I don't think they did it because of what George Washington said. Probably didn't know what George Washington said, right? I mean, they probably didn't have textbooks for that in it back then, that time. So I think they were doing it because that was a higher calling. This is my belief. I mean, I believe that your Montgomery Point Marines and those who was like them in the other service, I think they had a higher calling for why they decided to serve their nation. But, and with that executive order, you know, those very first black U.S. Marines, although they had to build their own camp, that was another thing, right? I mean, you saw some of the pictures there, I mean, with the Montgomery Point, and some of them here, I'm sure can tell you the story of how they had to really go in there and clean out the snakes and the bears and everything else that was there and run them off so that they could build their own camps so that they could become Marines. I mean, that was something. And then, you know, as they say, but it happened, the rest of it was history. Although the training, the Marine Corps had to allow the blacks to join, they trained them separately in segregated camps. Now, why, and we probably often wonder why would that be, and I believe, again, this is right, I haven't seen it written anywhere, but I think that was just the Marine Corps' approach where they could adhere to the letter of the law without adhering to the intent of the law. You know, the letter of the law said you have to admit them into the service, but that was really just to bring them in was not the intent of the law. The intent of the law was to integrate all the services. And, but the Marine Corps, you know, we said, okay, well, we'll bring them in, we'll put them in a camp over there, we'll have them separated, and but yet still, we would comply. And, you know, during that time, more than 19,000 men trained at Montgomery Point. Over 19,000, about 13,000, they saw action in our nation, right now, our nation's battles. And the history books now are filled with those likes of Sergeant Major Edgar Huff and Sergeant Major Lewis Roundtree, and who went on serving not just in World War II, but also in the career in Vietnam. And they earned highest decorations, Bronze Star, and Silver Star, and Purple Hearts, just like any other war fighter that we've seen. They were in there doing their bidding of their nation. You know, that 19,000 went on to serve. Served with great valor and with great professionalism. And I'll tell you that I, for one, and I'm grateful for that. People like myself, and, you know, the master sergeant there, we're grateful for what they did. We're grateful because, you know, although I, again, as I mentioned, I thought I said that I know we're all destined for something, and. But I don't think that I would have been where I was able to become in the Marine Corps had it not been for what those Montgomery Point Marines did back in the early 40s. May would have happened, but certainly not in the time that I did. Because had others been left to their own devices, they would not have even been in the Marine Corps. They certainly would have stayed segregated and would not have had the opportunities that they did. Yeah, so I'm grateful that they broke down those barriers and they really changed the face of the United States Marine Corps. And every Marine who has come after has benefited from what those Montgomery Point Marines doing way so long ago. And their bravery and leadership has continued, even when they got out. So again, even when they got out of the Marine Corps, we found that whether it be the training that they received, they went on to serve in other areas. You know, some teaching, some in civil rights efforts. They just continue to serve. And you see it even to this day. And And I'll tell you that because of that, I've learned an awful lot. And one that I often like to point to is a guy by the name of Hashmark Johnson. And Hashmark Johnson is my hero. Hashmark Johnson is from, down in Alabama, just south of the little town that I grew up in. Maybe don't call out places town down there, right? But it's just a country. I mean, sometimes you may have a traffic light or a flashing light there, you know, that's about it, maybe a crossroad. And in fact, that is where Hashmark from. I went back and looked for his place, and I rode throughout, and it was just a crossroad somewhere, but it's no longer there. But I know that when I look back and I'm looking at what he did, and I've committed myself to keeping his legacy alive, and because he has taught us so much. You know, he started his journey early in life down there. He actually attended Spelman College here. He actually attended the college that I attended. He attended Spelman College back in 1921, 22. He was there to be trained as a minister. And then when he left there, when the services began to open their doors, he joined the Army. And then when the Navy decided to open their doors, he got out of the Army. No, not because he didn't like the Army, but he got out of the Army and he joined the Navy. And then when the Marine Corps opened their doors, he got out of the Navy and joined the Marine Corps. Can you imagine watching the Marine Corps as a 37-year-old? He was 36. That's why they call him hash marks, because he had hash marks. He didn't even have a rank. But he had hash marks to know his years of service. And he was 37-year-old when he did that. So what he has taught me, as I look through his life, and one of the things he taught me, that losing and failure is merely just how you feel before you win. Because he eventually won, and you can look at, so the losses and failures that he achieved early in life, that was just the feeling that he had because he continued to stay the path and eventually he's going to win. And that's the way I see us, those mind-performing rings. And that because hope really springs from despair. And I think that it is our sacred responsibility to give of ourselves to bring about that desired change that we see. And that's the way I see Hashmark Johnson and other people. They've committed themselves to doing that. Because our history, so as I learned that, I also learned that it is our history that brings together our past, our present, and our future. And so it helps us to understand that past and to see how it informs our culture and it informs our heritage and it informs us against compromise and mediocrity. I mean, as I look at Hashmark, I said, I have to keep that. You know, for me to fail would be doing a disservice to his legacy. And so I was thinking as I was watching people come in, I was looking at the young folks here. Everybody's over there. I saw this gentleman over here, and you and your son, I think it was your son that's with you. Yeah, could you both stand up? I mean, I just want to tell you, it did my heart good. And I know there are others here, but I just saw the two of them walk in. And I thought about my comments about this past, and what it is that we do, and how we need to pass that history along to our young people. Because if we're going to have them prepared to take us to the future, we have to have him doing what this young man here is doing. He's his role model that his son can look up to. He even got him in a coat and a hat for the other, a nice shirt there. His trousers are pulled up. Look around. That's the young man standing up. See, here's another. Look at him. He's got a nice shirt. He's got his trousers pulled up around, and he's setting an example. I say that because not all of you see that. There you go. So we don't give you anything, but you have the opportunity to pursue what the Constitution guarantees. But now I also tell you that although the Constitution guarantees that You know, no nation, no matter how powerful, can guarantee anything that it can't defend. Okay, so you have to have a military service that allows that nation to be able to guarantee that. Can't you, you know, when we all, everyone in the military, when we join, we swear that we're going to support the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. Which means that even those who are against those things that the Constitution holds dear, whether it be domestic or foreign, you know, we have sworn that we're going to fight over that. And so it is really that's why I talk about a higher calling that I think in my Marines they knew that certain part before anybody like I did, because I think they understood that, because they are in fact that members of this greatest generation that they have. Because since the day that they joined, since they trained there, you know, and they went on to do all those things that we asked them to do. And the legacy of Monk Point Marines, I think, represents what's best about this nation and about our history. Because it truly is a proud history that we celebrate. Because between 42 and 49, you heard the history when our nation needed this strength to fight. These men stepped forward. They stepped forward with 13,000 as I mentioned to serve. And they served in various capacities. And we are thankful that history now continues to be written. The Congressional Gold Medal that we talk about, which is the highest rated award that's bestowed by Congress for distinguished achievement, was awarded in 2011. On the 23rd of November, the President signed that into law. I have to tell you, I tried to get him to sign it on the 10th of November. That was my goal, because we just couldn't get it there. I was sure that we had it. I was sure we had it. And we was going to get through there, but we couldn't get it there. So it was on the 23rd of November, that was one proud moment in my career to be able to work on that. And you talked about me being in the inauguration, the leading procession for President Obama. But I think the award of the Congressional Gold Medal was equally a proud moment for me when I was able to. And so now what we find is that, you know, what once we had was a separation, a segregated history in the Corps. We now see that these two legacies are coming together. And that's what General Amos and I talked about when we was doing this, was having these legacies. We're one Marine. We want these legacies to come together. We want these legacies to come together. And I know that can happen. It can happen with efforts like what you all have here, and it will happen, continue to happen around the Corps. Because we put different things in place. We put different programs in place to ensure that it happens. Whether you go to boot camp, whether you just go to officer training school, whether you go to AWS, these classes about the Monument Corps Marines are now being taught. And everyone goes away from that being better off for it. So we honor those Monument Corps Marines, honor those who are here today. And I certainly thank each and every one of you for coming to help us honor them. Because the day after, the day after we had the award, the Congressional Gold Medal in Emancipation Hall at the Capitol, General Amos, he brought back as many Monument Corps Marines as we could get. We brought them back for a ceremony at Marine Barracks. Mr. Elijah Walton, he came and he has his book with him. And I didn't realize that he and I had taken so many pictures together at that ceremony while he was there. And so we got to look through the book again and relive some of those proud moments. And just like this book, just like other books, people are now beginning to read all about that. So for those service in the past, I mean, for those of us who are today, we truly stand on, you've heard me say it before, so we stand on your shoulders. Because you are, in fact, the giants of our history in the Marine Corps. And had it not been for what you and your fellow Monument Corps Marines did, opening up those doors from 70 years ago that truly guaranteed that I and others like me would have the opportunity to serve in this finest fighting force the world has ever known, the United States of America. And, you know, we take advantage of that. We take advantage of those opportunities. And we understand, and that's why I was pointing to the young folks, talking about the Constitution, because there will be opportunities, and you know, you have to take advantage of those opportunities, because if you don't, then there's nothing more than a waste of promises, is what it is, because the Constitution guarantees it, but if you don't take advantage of it, it's just a waste of promise that you get it. So the people have paved the way, you know, George Barris from all walks of life, not just my life, have paved the way for the many thousands of us who've come after it. And the story is one of triumph over adversity. I say hope springs from despair. You know, in failure, you know, it's not an option, but there are excuses for failure. And I just been one, and I encourage our young folks to not take excuses, not make excuses for failure. Don't let others give you excuses for failure. So I'm gonna stop at that, because I just want you to honor these people. Is Marines to come in. So really, thank you all for helping those like Mr. Nelson to hold high the torch of democracy. And that's what this bank is about. It's about recognizing those who committed their lives. And so thank you all, and thank you all for your attention, and God bless you.